Why was robbing banks the crime of choice for crooks in the 70s and 80s?
Well, for a start, it was a lot easier to find banks back in those days. I mean, if you were looking for a bank to rob now, you know, they're all shut. But there were other kind of social factors. There was no CCTV for a start, until, of course, this one here, which is CCTV footage of somebody robbing a bank. But prior to this particular moment, there wasn't any. There wasn't much security. Banks were very easy to case. Like, you walk down your own high street, you'd see a bank, you can walk in, you can queue up, you can bring some money to change. And while you're doing that, you can see everything around you. You can see where the tellers are. You can see where the safes are. And nobody's going to remember you when you come back in a week later or 2 days later. You point a gun at them, they're not looking at your face. They're looking down the barrel of the gun. In half a minute, you can be out again with the money on the street in your getaway car. And so it was easy, basically.
And this is just such an incredible story. I mean, it's almost Dickensian with guns. It's Russell Mad Dog Cox and Raymond John Denning. They both grew up in boys' homes.
That's
Tell
right.
us about... there was a horrible incident in particular that Ray Denning witnessed as a child. Tell us about that.
Yeah, well, when Ray Denning was 10 years old, his father was in jail, but both Russell Cox... So I must say, was neither a Russell nor Mad nor a dog nor a Cox.
No, yeah.
He was... Both their fathers were petty criminals, not particularly successful petty criminals. Ray Denning's father was in jail when Ray was 10 years old. He contacted his mother to say he was coming out of jail. She'd married another guy during the time he was inside. Out of fear, apparently, for what the father might do, Ray Denning's mother set herself alight in front of him and actually burned to death in front of the eyes of her 10-year-old son, running around the house trying to put herself out. And if that's what you see, you know, when you close your eyes when you're 10 years old, it's impossible to put yourself in the imagination of that boy who, as you say, the next thing that happens to him is just put in abusive, violent boys' homes.
So how is it they hooked up? How did they come to work together? And why were they considered heroes of the underworld?
Well, they came to work together in much the same way that all criminals come to work together. They met in jail. In this case, when they were both adults, they were in Katingle, which was one of many jails in New South Wales that's been marketed as sort of the ultimate escape-proof prison. Katingle was a high-tech prison. There was no natural light, no natural air. Everything was air-conditioned but windowless. Russell Cox escaped from the escape-proof jail and then tried to get back into it, which is another story entirely. A few years later, Ray Denning escaped from Grafton, which at one time was also touted as escape-proof. Denning went down, found Cox, they teamed up and allegedly began committing armed robberies together in Queensland.
And Mark, why did Russell Cox try to break back into jail?
He'd left his mates behind. There's all kinds of stories about who was supposed to go with him on the breakout from the escape-proof jail. One story has Denning as among the people that were supposed to go with him. Others suggest he came back for two criminals called Jockey Smith and Marco Motrick. But it was an incredible thing to do. Like, A, by almost by definition, people don't escape from escape-proof jails. But B, to actually risk going back in to free your mates, that's what gave him sort of hero status in the underworld and a status that he still enjoys today. I mean, I'm not sure he actually enjoys it. That's probably wrong. But still holds.
Was it glamorous the way he busted out of jail? You know, was there a poster of Rita Hayworth involved or anything like that?
No, it wasn't this kind of John Killick thing where the girlfriend came down with a helicopter and lifted him out of Silverwood. I think it was the dead of night in Malabar, which, you know, I think we both know how glamorous that can be.
We do. So Ray Denning actually loved tormenting the police. What did he do?
Well, Ray Denning was actually a campaigner against what used to be called verbals, which was police fabricated confessions, and against the biff or the bash, which was a kind of reception afforded to new prisoners in maximum security jails, prisoners who had previously defied the establishment by doing things that are pretty much, you know, against the vibe of prison, such as escaping or indeed breaking back in again once you'd escaped. So it used to be that prisoner would go into maximum security prison, a bunch of guards would strip him, beat him with hands, with fists, and with batons. Denning was beaten because he had previously bashed a warder who later died during a pathetic escape attempt. He was beaten harder than even your average intractable prisoner and more regularly. So when he came out, as I say, he started to campaign against the beatings, against the verbals. He was hidden by a network, a sort of underground network, who safe housed him, but he kept popping up. He'd pop up and he'd put his handprints on the door of Sydney CIB. He reviewed the movie Stir, a prison movie for Triple J, two Triple J as it was. He actually recorded a new call sign for Triple J when it went from Double J to Triple J. He signed the guest book on a police launch, a boat named after a police commissioner. He supposedly turned up in state parliament. He had to constantly keep popping up so as to keep his cause in the public eye. You know, he couldn't just disappear. And but eventually he did just disappear and he ended up robbing banks again because really it was the only thing he knew.
And what happened to them, Mark? Are they still alive today?
Russell Cox is still alive and lives in Queensland and does not call himself Russell Cox. And I have to apologise every time I use mad dog. As I say, he was not mad. He certainly wasn't a dog. And he actually had the words, the name mad dog, expunged from his prison record because he said it wasn't a real alias. Who knew that a man has control over his real alias? Wow. But he did. I think he perhaps preferred Cox the Fox, and that's how his associates refer to him to this day. Wow. Ray Denning died of a heroin overdose, which almost everybody I spoke to believed was a hot shot. Wow. The cops believed it was a hot shot from the Crims. The Crims believed it was a hot shot from the cops. I don't know.
Wow. Mm. Amazing story, mate.
Well, it is.
Mark Devon's new book is called Public Enemies, Russell Mad Dog Cox, Ray Denning and the Golden Age of Armed Robbery. Mark, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Jamie.
Thank you.